Today we would be talking about the various perspectives in human geography. We have already discussed the radical approach and the welfare approach in the previous session. In today's session, we would be talking about the behavioral approach. Now, behavioral approach, as the name suggests, deals with behavior. So what is important to note here is it does not include just the component of geography, but along with that, it also includes the component of psychology, or I can say aspects of sociology. What we are trying to understand here is human being as a dynamic person whose behavior influences his actions. So person make choices, and those choice is governed by the pre-owned knowledge that the person has. Now let's say To understand this in a very simple fashion, I can give you a simple example. For example, there are two persons, me and my friend, and I have to go out for a grocery shopping. I believe I will go to the place that is nearest to me. My friend believes he or she will go to a place that is providing the grocery at the most economical cost. Despite of the distance that the person has to travel. That means there are two persons who are living close by but still have varied choices. So for example, that is the place of residence. I travel say 1 kilometer for the grocery to reach to a destination. My friend travels say 3 kilometers to a place to reach the grocery shop where he gets the most economical grocery shopping. So that is how we understand the behavior of an individual. Now why this approach came into origin? This approach came into origin as a result of the developments that were made in the positivism, the statistical methods that came out, and the quantitative revolution that had taken place. But this theory kind of opposed all the three concepts. The reason being, most of the theories which are based on these concepts, say for example, we can do a central place example of central place theory that we have already discussed. If you go back and view that lecture, you will get an idea. Under the central place theory, we talked about a rational economic man. So when I say the man is economic and rational, that means I am deciding some prerequisites, and that has to be there in order to proceed with this theory. The next concept here was the concept of isotropic surface, that is an even surface. That is again, I could say a very unrealistic example, because in natural surroundings, you do not have a surface that is isotropic in nature. So you have surface that is uneven, and I cannot say whole of the surface is similar or same. So these were some of the assumptions that were made under the statistical methods or the quantitative approach that took place. Now these methods believed man to be rational and economic, and since the man was rational and economic, his main motive was maximizing the profit. And if I say the main motive was maximization of profit, that means the person was considered as a economic man again, and this concept was wholeheartedly rejected by Wolpert in around 1964 challenged this concept and said, in the case study that he did, he said, the farmers are not optimizers, but satisfiers. So based on this theory, you cannot say they will optimize their production to reach a maximum profit, but rather they would satisfy the needs and the demands that are generated in the area. So the basic opposition that laid the foundation for the behavioral approach was the opposition in the fields of quantitative approach, the positive approach, or I could say the normative methods that were discussed, and finally the various statistical methods that were used. Now, what formed the basis of behavioral approach? When I say behavioral approach, as I mentioned, it talks about behavior of an individual. That means the person has the freedom to make choice, and that choice is governed by the predetermined knowledge that the person has. Again, this was developed as an alternative to spatial location. When I say spatial location, I am trying to measure it in terms of the region or the space, and that was an opposition to, again, the quantitative revolution concept, which talked about spatial location. This theory specifically focused on the cognitive element. Cognitive means understanding. So whenever I'm talking about any concept that deals with understanding a theory, I talk about the cognitive decision making, and behavioral approach specifically focused on the quantitative methods. Again, one of the major aim of this method was moving from aggregate, that is a group of population, to understanding an individual or a limited set of people. So rather than working about on a huge set of population, behavioral approach tried to focus on an individual and tried to produce response from each and every individual. The next was a deep relationship between environment and man. Now to explain this, I can say, we'll be moving on to evolution later. Just to explain this, I can say I have a set of environment. That environment is divided as objective environment and behavioral environment. This objective environment deals with the actual world and is, in more sense I could say, direct and applicative in nature, while the behavioral environment talks about mind and it tries to pick out the indirect senses or the responses from an individual. So when I say the behavioral environment talks about mind, I can say it is more focused on a perception of an individual. Now to explain this, I can say if I have to get a direction to reach my school, there can be two ways. One is, this is the campus and this is me who is traveling. I can reach the school directly through the main highway that follows. That is one way. The another way is, I want to avoid the highway because of the huge traffic, and I will take a road that is going through the periphery, takes much higher time or much larger time as compared to the main highway, but still I like to go through this road because you do not have huge traffic or traffic jams on this road. Now there can be two persons who are trying to reach the school. One believes to follow the highway because that's a kind of direct route. The other prefers to go through an alternative route which escapes the traffic jams and the traffic on that road. So that is how the perception of an individual varies. So here is a same person and here is another person who has a different perception about it. I can give you another example. Say you have a farm. In that farm, I could say you have a village. That village is predominantly having three kind of farmers or three kind of castes who are running out the farms in that region. Now the person A, who is a kind of rich farmer, has around 20 to 50 acres of land, and the basic method of working on that land is, say, tractors. The other person, who has a small sets of land, works on the basis of an intensive farming, and that patch of land is sufficient to satisfy his own family or his close relatives, I could say. Now, according to person A, if I give them a 20 acre of land here, according to person A, this land would be considered as a small parcel because he does not feel that his tractor can run freely in this area, and it would be good if he has a much bigger area as compared to this. On the other hand, you have a person C who has a small patch of land here, but he is satisfied with that patch of land because he does not have that modern means of farming, and he believes what he is getting from this farm is sufficient to fulfill his family. So again, there is variation in the perception of individual A and individual C here. So that is how we understand the behavioral environment, and this behavioral environment is covered nowhere except the ambit of behavioral approach, because under quantitative revolution or any other approach, what we do is we directly count out the areas. A has this much, C has this much, so we can say based on the area that an individual has, we can do out the calculations. But what an individual perceives or what an individual feels is only included under the ambit of behavioral approach. Now let's see how this behavioral approach evolved. Now this has started long back with a concept that was propounded by Kant, and later on Reckless tried to bring it forward. Reckless was a French person, and he tried to explain that man is not passive. He works out actively, and there are changes that man keeps on doing, or I can say he is dynamic in nature. The next was Saussure. He was an American, and he tried to explain the concept of interaction of man and environment, and that interaction of man and environment affects the physical surroundings. Then came Wolpert, that we already talked about. He criticized the concept of economic man and the aim of profit maximization. And in 1964, he did a case study on farmers, and he said farmers are not optimizers, but they are satisfiers. Then there was Crick. He was considered the first person who gave out a behavioral model, or the first behavioral model was proposed by Crick. And again, he tried to came out about the information that with the same information, there can be different meanings that can be derived for the same set. As I gave the example of the farming area, and one person considers a huge set of farm area to be insufficient, while another who has a small patch of land considers that to be sufficient. And after Crick, there were numerous people who came out. The most important was Boulding and Gould. They tried to follow the principles given by Crick, and they tried to develop impressions of the world by providing a kind of close contact with the environment. So this was a kind of evolutionary tree that was propounded under the behavioral approach. Altogether, I can say this approach focused on the concept of generalization. It is a kind of inductive approach that tried to provide outcomes from the existing or the ongoing processes. And the next what we are trying to understand is the criticism, or why this behavioral approach could not sustain a lot. The main criticism was the conflicting terminology that most of the geographers in behavioral approach used. That was like kind of optimizer and satisfier. So people were not able to comprehend the close differences that was there in the approach. That was the conflict of terminology. That's the first thing I could say. The next criticism was there was more focus on the laboratory experiment rather than the real groundwork experiments. There were more and more of laboratory experiments which did not give as good results as the kind of that were required for the behavioral approach. There was lack of communication, lack of followers who propounded the concept of behavioral approach. It emphasized on egocentric approach of an individual. So when I'm trying to give too much priority to an individual, it tries to focus on to the egocentered approach of an individual. It tried to treat environment into an aspect of which was considered as non-dimensional. And when you consider an environment to be non-dimensional, it is difficult to find out the relationship that you are trying to predict for an individual to that region. So that was another one of the major criticism of behavioral approach. Despite of these criticism that the behavioral approach faced, it is considered as one of an important theories because it was highly interdisciplinary in nature. It tried to include the concepts from the field of sociology and psychology along with the existing spatial concepts of geography. It was a kind of generalized theory that was first time aimed to introduce the aspect of individual and the dedication of an individual towards the environment. And finally, it was inductive in nature. So it was trying to give out results from the ongoing processes that are happening. So because of these, this theory still survived. And the next thing that we would be covering in the further sessions would be the quantitative revolution and the system analysis. You can subscribe to ExamRace channel for any further updates. Stay tuned. Have a good day ahead.